All right, we should be live.
All right, guys.
Alrighty, we should be live.
All right.
Alrighty, we should be live.
All right, cool.
All right,
should be live.
Alrighty, we should be live.
All right.
Nathan Burnett. Guys, Nathan Burnett, episode 25.
Episode 29, guys.
Episode 31.
Episode 27.
Episode 21. Episode 28.
Episode 26.
Episode 34.
Episode 35, the Halloween episode.
Perfect. Episode 36.
Episode 33, guys. It's been a minute.
Hey guys, so as you can see by that intro, a lot has happened this year. A lot has changed over this year, and hopefully my quality of videos, quality of audio, that sort of thing has gotten better over the years. I would like to think so. And we've done a lot this year, and that was sort of what that intro was supposed to show. This year we went from like 100 subs to almost 500, which, you know, over quadrupled our amount, which is really crazy to me. And I can't really get all my thoughts out right now, so there will probably be a pinned comment about it, so y'all can go in the comments and read that. But this year has just been really crazy and a lot has happened, so I thank you guys for that, and I'll probably talk more about it at the end of the video as well. I don't want to give like a massive speech at the beginning, but thank you guys. And this is sort of video is gonna try and go chronologically to show how the channel has evolved and how long y'all have stayed with me. Even though it's only 1 year, that 1 year, so much has happened. So yeah. Thank you.
Hey, what's up, guys? So, it's taken me a minute to get, like, the best of 2022, just because I've been working so much, because I'm trying to get that PC, which I've said before. But this should go up on December 31st, hopefully in time, before it actually, like, rolls over to 2023. And I think I did the same thing last year where, like, I dropped it, like, right on December 31st. Last year, was the first, like, best of video I did. And I had, like, this really cool idea. It was sort of, like, a formal event, almost like, I don't know, like, an award show, you know? Like, I dressed up in sort of, like, a suit. And, like, I went through, like, everything that the channel went through for the year. That sort of thing, and I really liked that idea, and I think it was really cool. I'm not gonna put on like a suit or anything right now, just because it's late at night, and you know I don't want to have to, you know, iron all the shirts, put them on, record a video, and then take it off. But I'm still going to do the same sort of thing where like I go through the year, some of the things that like I felt like were impactful for the channel. That sort of thing, like big events, talk about like the evolution of like my editing style, my researching style, that sort of thing, like again, sort of the evolution of the channel throughout the year, stuff that I think, like I think that sort of like using the best of as a timeline is something that I really like, especially for this type of channel. Like I know with like gaming channels or something, like best of, they can just throw a bunch of random funny clips together, but with something like a podcast and like this sort of thing, and talking about like sports and like news, you know, with news, it's like what's happening then, sort of thing. So I feel like with the best of it's cooler and better to sort of go like chronologically, and you can be like, almost like a YouTube rewind and be like, oh yeah, like that happened this year. Like that seemed like a long time ago. That happened this year. Sort of thing. So this is gonna go sort of like chronologically, like January to December, but also like there will be some sort of like compilation moments like put in as well. Like I think I talked, if I remember correctly, I talked a lot about LeBron this year. I talked a lot about like team chemistry, and I always talk a lot about team chemistry. I did that last year too, but and like there will be like certain sections where like I'm focusing a lot on like this topic, like, oh, here's like me talking about LeBron compilation. Here's me talking about offensive rating compilations type thing, but also like chronologically. But with that being said, let's go ahead and get into it.
What's good? Missed you, my boy. How you doing?
So the very first video I posted in January dropped on January 1st. I posted a lot in January because this is still when last year during December, I decided to do sort of like a 25 days of Nathan Butnett, 25 days of Christmas type thing where I tried to post like every day in December up until like January 10th or something like that, because that's when school started back up for me. And so the very first video I posted was, should the NBA suspend the league again? And this was because there were still a few things going on with COVID, players getting COVID, players getting injured, games being postponed, and it was sort of like a lot of games are getting postponed. Like, what's going to happen here? Is it going to be a 2020 situation again? Like, is the league going to suspend again? And that was the very first video that I posted in 2022, which was on January 1st. It's not one of my greatest videos. Again, like my evolution, like my videos have evolved, I like to think, throughout this year. So my videos are definitely better, I would like to say. At least y'all are obviously the judge of that. But that's sort of where it started this year. And then right after, the day after, again, because I tried to post every day in January, I posted, should the Spurs tank this year?
While trying to think of topics for daily uploads, I keep seeing the same debate appear over and over and over again across YouTube, Discord, and Twitter. Should the Spurs tank this year?
It's still no secret that one of our biggest weaknesses is on the tall end of the court, without the David Robinson or Tim Duncan players we used to have. Now the 2022 draft is packed with power forwards and centers that can fill that spot, such as Paolo Banchero or my personal favorite, Chet Holmgren. But that's another video. Either way, whoever gets picked high in this draft at that position is sure to be a great asset for any team, especially the Spurs needing that big man, as we just said. The problem with this, however, is a worse record doesn't exactly equate to a better pick. Going back to Tim Duncan, the Celtics and the Grizzlies both had more losses that season, but the Spurs got the number one pick instead. More recently, there's been the Bulls with Derrick Rose and the Cavs with Kyrie Irving.
Again, the Spurs are sort of unsure of that themselves as well. A lot of the fans are wanting the Spurs to tank because, again, Victor Wembanyama, like, generational talent. He's going to be, like, an amazing player. You know, he's someone we really need. He could be, like, the next sort of Tim Duncan player, especially under Popovich. But yet we're still, like, winning every now and then. And then, obviously, like, we've made a lot of changes to our roster, and how is that going to affect things? So in this video, since it was back in January, it actually wasn't about tanking for Victor. It was actually like talking about Chet and Banchero, and that sort of thing. And that was obviously back when we still had DeJounte and Primo, and it was like, how does Banchero and Chet sort of go together with this group and everything like that. And I honestly think that, Chet, Banchero, that's a discussion that will be had later, because obviously I made some predictions about them. Some of them were right, some of them were wrong. I think they could have worked with the Spurs, but Banchero is doing amazing in Orlando now. And again, we'll sort of touch on that later in the video. But this was another, the second video I posted this year. The thumbnail my thumbnails have definitely changed since then. I don't know what I would do different about this thumbnail. I mean, it gets the point across. It has Derek White and the tank in it. But it's not as great as some of my other thumbnails. So it definitely would... I would definitely do it different if I did it again. So a little bit after that video, I posted my Have Triple Doubles Become Overrated video, which I sort of touched on a little while ago, talking about, you know, like scoring records and everything like that. Again, this video was a little bit shorter. It was only like 3 minutes long. I usually aim to make my videos around like 7 or 8 minutes or longer if they're more in depth. 3 minutes seems like a really short video for me. Like I couldn't, like, to me, whenever I see like a video under 6 minutes, for me, it means that I wasn't able to get my thoughts out well enough or have enough to talk about to really make it into a video. So it's a really short video, but I do think it was a topic that was important, which leads into a video that I made later this year about scoring records, which is the fact that the offensive rating has been changing so much. It really affects like the impact of what these records that are being broken are. So right after that, I also made a video called The Most Improved Player That Isn't on the List, and I actually think that this was a really good video. Again, it's a video that was only about 3 minutes, but it carried on into this season, and actually had like a pretty good prediction in it. Basically, it was about Grant Williams and basically how Grant Williams is improving more than any other player, but because he's so unimpactful, I don't want to say unimpactful, but his points aren't like huge. They aren't getting noticed as much, and like in the thumbnail, I put the words under the radar, basically. But if you actually look at the stats and the eye test, he is the player that has improved significantly. But because he's still like under double digits per game, it's gonna go unnoticed. Like if we look at his stats per season, he started at 4.7 points, and then when I made the video, he jumped from 4.7 points per game to 7.8 points per game, almost doubling his points per game. And now he's at 9.2 points per game, so he's over doubled his points per game since the 2020-21 season. And if we look at his past few games, he was plus 20 against Milwaukee, he was plus 10 against Minnesota. He had 3 14-point games in the last month. He had an 18-point game, a 11-point game, and a 10-point game. As well as having 4 assists, 4 rebounds, you know, 3 steals, a lot of 2-steal games. So he really is improving, and I talked about in the video, he has an amazing work ethic just like other players that we've seen. But again, because he's still at 9.2 points per game, it's not going to be as noticed as, you know, some of these other amazing players. But he still has that work ethic, and he is improving drastically. And, you know, we got to see a little bit of minutes from him in the playoffs, where he didn't have, like, that great of points per game, but he had really good defense. And that definitely made an impact. So it's cool to see, like, a prediction that I made a while back, you know, sort of being significant in the future and how things played out against the Warriors. After this, I made an all-star trailer.
If I want it, I'ma grab it. If I want it, I'ma have it. Christian Dior, Christian Dior. I'm up in all the stores. I make a call. I make a call and it's war. Yeah, you can take the score. We up on the board. Whoop,
And we all living lavish. If I want it, I'ma have it.
Yeah. I said I feel invincible. Hold on. It's 100 in the spot. I won't keep going. It's 85 just to walk on. I don't talk to this. Cause a lot of these be corny. I'm feeling horny. And I shoot like Robert Horry.
I make a call. To score. Yeah, you can check the score. We up on the board. And we all living lavish. If I want it, I'ma have it. I make a call. I make a call to score. Yeah, you can check the score. We up on the board. And we all living lavish. If I want it, I'ma have it. I make a call. I make a call to score. Yeah, you can check the score. We up on the board. And we all living lavish. If I want it, I'ma have it.
Shoot for the stars. That is something that I started last year, and I was hoping to make it an annual thing, and I hope to keep it an annual thing. I don't think I've done one for this season yet, and if I haven't, then I should soon, because the All-Star voting is out. But I do kind of like the idea of challenging my editing style and making a trailer in under 24 hours. I think that's a really like unique and cool idea. So I definitely want to keep that going. And I was really happy with actually how the editing and how it came out. And then just after this, I started sort of making the TikTok push where shorts get a lot of views on YouTube nowadays. So a lot of my uploads after this were sort of the YouTube shorts and TikToks and that sort of thing. Right after that, I had the one-year reunion with Fernando. For those of you that don't know, that are recent subscribers, I actually started this podcast with a co-host, and it had a different name. And he just couldn't make the recordings a lot, and we basically came to a mutual decision that I was going to do this on my own because I was putting more effort into it and I enjoyed doing it, but it wasn't like a toxic break or anything like that. Again, it was like sort of a mutual understanding. So I decided to rename it to Nathan Budnett, and for the one-year reunion or the one-year anniversary of creating this basketball podcast, I drove to my old college where this started, because now I go to UTSA, but I actually didn't go to UTSA before. I went to a different college that's about 5 hours away. So I planned to drive back there, meet up with Fernando. We recorded in his dorm, just like how we recorded in my dorm when I was still at that college. And it was sort of a really a reunion thing. It was really cool. I really enjoyed it. We hung out in the town after we recorded, and it was just really cool being like back at like my old college, that sort of thing, re-seeing the campus. And as much as I didn't like that town, which is why I left the college, it was still cool like walking around and, you know, like hanging out with Fernando and sort of getting almost nostalgia of the old college, even though I had been there the year before. It's sort of hard to explain, but you know, there was sort of like a nostalgic factor in like being back at like the college and everything like that, and seeing Fernando, seeing a good friend, all that sort of stuff. And like looking back at like sort of like we're doing with this best of, like looking at where it started and where it is now, was really cool. And then he got to hold the Nathan Budnett trophy that I made, all that good stuff. So
hey yo man, damn, what's taking homie so long, son?
50, calm down, really coming.
Fuck! I said, son, pull off!
He just saw it through the fucking car, so it was spoiled a little bit, but. All right, bro.
Oh, shit.
So you and me started this podcast together, so I figured it'd only be fair if you got to hold it for a little bit.
Bad shit. Take my picture.
Yeah, bro.
Damn. The Nathan Vanette logo. Shit.
Yeah, bro. It's got the fucking Nathan Vanette logo on it and everything, bro. That's what I did for 100 subs and everything, but I was like, you know what? I'm going to bring this so Fernando can hold it, because we started this shit together.
Dude, so,
that's what I'm saying, bro.
Yeah, the Nathan Vanette logo.
Yeah, bro.
That's dope, man.
Yeah.
I just want to talk to him.
Why do you have a shotgun?
I just want to talk to him.
Dad, this is ridiculous.
I just want to talk to him. I just want to talk to him. I just want to talk to him.
It is not his fault.
I just want to shoot him. I just want to talk to him.
You can't shoot him.
Wait, what?
Sort of later into January and getting into February, I posted videos that I really enjoyed and I still think are some of my best videos that didn't get as many views as I was hoping, because, again, they're some of my favorite videos. But sometimes that's just how YouTube goes. You know, you post a really good video, it doesn't get that many views. You post a video that sucks, and somehow it's the most amazing video. I really liked, my thumbnails around this period. And I liked my research and sort of the effort that I put in. The future Cavs dynasty, I really liked that video because that was before they got Donovan Mitchell, and I said that the Cavs could be contenders, and then unfortunately Jared Allen got injured.
The Cleveland Cavaliers have been the punching bag of the NBA, being that they have essentially made their entire roster consistent of forwards or centers. Except, this seemingly weird decision has allowed them to dominate the league so far this season, consisting of many factors that I had predicted would be at the forefront of the NBA. With so many big men, the Cavaliers have obviously a lot of height on their roster, as we mentioned. But included with height also comes physicality. The Cavaliers are a very physical team that are using their bodies to their advantage and playing the way any big man would be coached to. Crashing the glass, posterizing, swatting balls for blocks, and so on. When playing against the Cavs as a guard or small forward, it's like wrestling against a full team of five above your weight class. This correlates to my next point. The Cleveland Cavaliers are bringing back defense. You heard me correct. The old adage, defense wins championships, is being stimulated and brought back to life predominantly by the Cleveland Cavaliers. Their immense size and power have allowed them to essentially build a super team in secret.
And I still believe that if Jared Allen wasn't injured, the Cavs could have gone far in that playoffs, and we'll see how far they get with Donovan Mitchell now. I also posted more of a controversial video called the LeBron James Media Curse.
With LeBron's status in the league, he's able to be a judge, jury, and executioner for any team he's on. Or in basketball terms, player, coach, and GM. This is only further propagated by LeBron's popularity and ego, having millions of fans chant for you versus the rest of the team, being the face of the league, and millions of people posting you on social media, and even being brought up in GOAT debates. With popularity comes power and protection. People are more likely to go along with you, whether it be from actual admiration or simply fear, which is exactly what I'm gonna get into. Quote, similarly, by playing in a larger market, many NBA fans of those markets expect more from their star players. This added pressure can be difficult on an NBA player and can lead to decreased efficiency and ability. Larger markets are notorious for their fans' expectations, and not being able to live up to those expectations can be detrimental to a player's future success with that team and with any teams they may play for. End quote. Which is exactly the point I want to make. But also, now imagine that rather than the stigma of a team's reputation, it was from one single player. Well, that is the case right now. The NBA has one player at the center of it, and that is King James.
And that was sort of talked about, like, how LeBron James, you know, the superstar effect, it brings more attention to whatever team he plays on. And so if a player screws up, they're going to get more attention to their screw-ups and how they're letting the team down. And, you know, that happened with Kyle Kuzma. It's happening with Russell Westbrook, that sort of thing. And then right after, in February, starting in February, in the start of February, right after the LeBron James media curse, I posted a video called Why LaMelo is a Future GOAT. And obviously that's a bit of an exaggeration, but, you know, it's for the title, it's for the views and all that. And this one got a bit more views than my previous videos, which I really liked, because, again, I put in, like, more effort into this video. And it was sort of comparing LaMelo's play style with Magic Johnson's play style. And, again, I do still feel like their play styles are very similar. But, unfortunately, LaMelo was injured at the start of the season. But I still think that if the Hornets can sort of figure out what's going wrong, you know, they keep making it to the play-in and then failing. But if the Hornets can figure it out and start making it deep in the playoffs, we'll see more of LaMelo. And people will be, like, more aware of LaMelo's game, because I think what's really holding LaMelo back is just the Hornets not doing that great. And that's why some people may not take that video as seriously. But LaMelo is a great player, and he is sort of playing in the same way that Magic Johnson did, and that and I feel like that is definitely going to have an impact. So again, go watch that video if you want more details on what I was talking about. But
how can LaMelo be the next GOAT? Well, let's talk about his ceiling. I think LaMelo can have a similar career to Magic Johnson.
Definitely not a good name.
I like that one.
Yeeks.
That's good.
No, seriously. Let's evaluate the points that we've made. LaMelo Ball is a 6'8 point guard. Similarly, Magic was 6'9, both pushing the limits of a tall point guard. We also talked about LaMelo's basketball IQ and playmaking ability. You can ask anyone who the best point guard of all time is, and most will say Magic because of his ability to pass the ball and playmake. And LaMelo is en route to have the same reputation for how he can facilitate.
So once again, towards the end of February, these are some videos that I really liked that didn't get that many views. But whenever I posted them on TikTok, they're actually most one of my most viewed videos over on TikTok. And it was what we learned from the 2021 Brooklyn Nets, which was talking about super teams, talking about the dunk contest, talking about the dunk contest, and how it has fundamentally changed and why the dunk contest will never be as great as it used to be.
The NBA dunk contest. What was once seen as one of the most exciting days of the NBA before playoffs is now seen as an embarrassment. And I'm sure you've seen on social media Shaq's face that used to look like this now looks like this. Now I know this point has been beaten into the ground, but one of the massive problems is the way the dunk contest is designed. It calls for an impossible task. In order to obtain a good dunk score, it needs to be creative. But in order to be creative, you also need to be original. Except, with 46 years of the dunk contest, everything has pretty much already been done. Plain and simply, there are limitations to the human body. There are only two choices: go with something that's already been done, or try and push the limit and fail.
Another video comparing Giannis to Tim Duncan, that sort of thing. And that sort of wraps up the month of February. February, I think, actually had a lot of great videos this year. It's just, unfortunately, they didn't get that many views. But I still really enjoyed making them, and I still feel like those are some of my better videos. So in March was when stuff really started popping off for the channel. In March, Pop broke the win record. And obviously, as a Spurs fan, that was hugely impactful. So I made an edit about Pop, People really enjoyed it. It didn't get that many views, but people loved it over on Instagram. People loved it on TikTok. You know, people that were Spurs fans were enjoying it. It's just on YouTube, the views didn't really reflect it. But it was an amazing video. I loved making it again. I loved the thumbnail that I made for it with the Fiesta, like 13.
Inductees. What an amazing class. I don't want to talk about him. He's gonna get mad at me if I talk about him. Sorry, Pop. Coach Pop. He's gonna be mad at me, but the standard you set, you showed up after I got drafted, you came to my island. Sat with my friends, my family. You talked with my dad. I thought that was normal. It's not. You're an exceptional person. Thank you for teaching me about basketball, but even beyond that, teaching me that it's not all about basketball. It's about what's happening in the world, about your family. For everything. Thank you for being the amazing human being that you are.
36. Immediately after, I took my best friend Old Guy Vibes to his very first Spurs game, and that was really fun, and I look forward to maybe doing another video like that soon if Old Guy Vibes wants to do it.
Dance and throw that ass up, blood so big I can pull your ass up. Drop it, I got my bags up, got big bags, you need to raise up, so do it.
Because I think it's a cool idea, sort of like the clash of like our different worlds and like different like hobbies and stuff like that. Sort of like if you have ever watched the Markiplier podcast called Go My Favorite Sports Team, like his friend Tyler has a major or a master's degree in sports, while Markiplier doesn't watch sports, and so they kind of like have this weird blend of knowledge, and I think it would be like really cool to do that sort of thing again, and it was a really fun time, and again I look forward to doing another video like that here soon. And every once in a while, like, I'll go and watch, like, that sort of video again, because, again, it was just really fun. Right after, I made a video that I liked, but I didn't expect to do so well. And it was comparing Cade Cunningham to LaMelo.
Cade Cunningham could have a similar career to LaMelo Ball. Both have caused their smaller market teams to get increased TV ratings by being high first-round draft picks, and both have similar play styles. When Cade was drafted, his biggest weakness was his turnovers, which was also LaMelo Ball's biggest weakness, according to NBADraft.net, which is a website that scouts out players before draft. However, LaMelo's biggest strength was his ball handling and playmaking, which allows for crossovers and precision passes. Cade Cunningham has also been showing these skills recently in clips such as these, where he passes through three defenders and has a spin move in the paint. Cade Cunningham now also has Marvin Bagley III after the trade that adds a similar dynamic to his play as Miles Bridges to LaMelo. For the full video, click on the link in the description and please subscribe for more.
And their play style with Marvin Bagley III and Miles Bridges, obviously Miles Bridges now, looking back, wasn't that great of a guy. You know, he got into all that controversy, but with their play style, Cade Cunningham and Marvin Bagley played very similar to LaMelo and the Hornets. And that video, again, ended up popping off, had almost 300 likes, you know, almost 70 comments, almost 10,000 views. So it was just like a normal video I would upload, and somehow it ended up getting like crazy views, which was really cool. And sort of after that, the boost sort of kept going, where obviously no videos were getting like crazy, like 10,000 views like that video. But it changed my average view count significantly. I thought my door was open for some reason, sorry. Where that changed my average view count significantly, where usually my average view count was like somewhere in the 30s or 40s. But now my average view count, like most of my views after that were in the hundreds, you know, like 120, 130. You know, some of the less watched ones were maybe like high 70s, high 80s, but still, that's a massive jump from the 30s and 40s. And I'm sure there's a way for me to check. Let me see if I can pull it up. How many like new subscribers I got from that video? Because that again, like, definitely helped like the channel a lot. So that video alone, the Cade Cunningham video, gained me almost 100 subscribers on its own. I gained 85 subscribers from that one video. People watched that video and decided to subscribe, which was really cool. And then right after that, again, like, I had an episode with Swiss Eel that I really liked, We talked about Chet Holmgren. We talked about March Madness. And that video got about 80 views, which is more than some of my podcast episodes were getting at the time. And me and Swishiel had, again, really good conversations about stuff we had already talked about, like the Cavaliers potentially doing a deep run, Westbrook and, like, the LeBron James effect, Holmgren, Banchero, LeBron, that sort of thing. And that sort of wrapped up the end of March, which again was a huge month for the channel, because of just everything that happened in that 1 month alone. So in April, I had another really good video, which is now the video that shows when you go to my channel, which is called Doc Rivers is a Terrible Coach. Again, something I still have a strong opinion on. I still completely agree with it. Ended up getting about 1,600 views, 60 likes, 25 comments. So for me, again, that's a really big video. Again, it sort of helped boost the rest of the channel going forward. I got about 15 subscribers from that video, and it really changed. Like, seeing that had a lot of views sort of, I think, carried my editing style going forward, where I had, like, a lot of different clips that were backing up, like, my claims on sort of showing where I got my research and how everything was edited and that sort of thing.
Doc, you think Ben Simmons can still be a point guard for a championship team like the one you guys want to become?
Yeah, David, I don't know that question or the answer to that right now.
The Benjamin struggled compared to their
Ben. Well, they didn't struggle. They didn't get a lot of shots, you know, in their defense. I think during that stretch, it was more James, than them. So, it's just a tough night.
I got the ball in the
house.
I did like this. Wait, come here.
Read the tape. Watch the tape.
Oh, we coming. You know me.
At the end of the game, we get the ball.
He got the bigs coming to him. I'm moving out the way like this.
Don't come to the ball.
You come to the ball.
You always come to the ball.
Watch the film.
Did I do like this though, right?
I saw this.
I was like, come here.
But if I come, the big guy was rolling to you. If I back up like that, I'm wide open.
In May, we hit 25 episodes in the podcast, so again, being about a year and a half in, shows I'm not the most consistent, unfortunately, but I would like to do this podcast every week. It's just, with school and work, sometimes I get busy since I still am a college kid, but I really like this thumbnail since I put a lot of effort into this thumbnail, and it was basically called the NBA Renaissance because it talked about the cycle that the NBA goes in, like something does really well. And then the league tries to continue with that trend, like three-point shooters, and then the NBA drafts more three-point shooters, which leads to taller players like Giannis and Jokic doing well. The NBA wants more big men because of that, which leads to three-point shooters doing really well, and the NBA wants more three-point shooters, and you see the cycle that goes on with that. Right after this as well, I posted a video on Zion, which was an amazing prediction because I basically said that when Zion comes back, he's going to be very dominant because everybody craps on him for his diet and being injured. But Joel Embiid had the same issue with Joel Embiid, not following his diet, getting injured. And now he scores 40 and 50 points in a game sometimes, and doing very well with the 76ers. And now Zion with the Pelicans is doing very well, especially with all the moves the Pelicans were able to make during the offseason because Zion was injured. And the Pelicans are just being incredibly dominant this season now. So it was a spot-on take, in my opinion, which is always a great feeling whenever you say something and get proven right. So those were sort of my bigger videos in the month of May, which was that Zion video and just the fact that we hit 25 episodes, which is really cool.
He is now in a situation where his career is in jeopardy of being derailed. Changes have got to be made.
We need you to trim down. Zion Williams is over 300 pounds in that photo. I don't care what anybody tells you.
I quit. I got to get...
Hey, come on, man.
What do you look like, Chuck?
Like me and you had a baby. God dang. That's too...
For the past 2 years, we've seen countless and countless memes talking about the problems with Zion. Whether it be injuries, jokes about his weight, or something else. More and more memes continued to get made, and it started to seem that the cool thing to do was to hate on Zion and make more memes. Snowballing and snowballing, until finally, even the city of New Orleans themselves decided to make one of the most obscene gestures I've seen in basketball for a long time, against a player on their own team. Except, Pelicans fans should be holding out hope, not hate. This isn't the first time we've seen this situation. A player that now has 5 All-Stars out of his 8 seasons played, a scoring record, an All-Rookie First Team, and many more awards, was in this same spot not too long ago. As the story progressed, the fans found more and more reasons to hate the number one pick. Zion was skipping rehab, ignoring his diet, and continuing to gain weight, with reports saying he ate a lot of pizza, drank a lot of sodas, and did not listen to his physical therapist. Now, as the end of Zion's contract looms in the near future, many question whether to re-sign him. Even the Pelicans executive said talking about an extension would be a challenge and very difficult conversation, while Zion, however, says he'd sign an extension as fast as he could. But as Van Gundy said, maybe we should cut Zion some slack. The iceberg goes much deeper. Let's take a minute and hit rewind.
Joel Embiid, who picked up enough momentum to be a favored top pick in Thursday's draft, is the latest of the fallen. The Kansas product injured the navicular bone in his right foot and had 2 screws inserted, which is fitting because this draft has officially become screwy. Embiid's combination of back and foot injuries make him a 7-foot red flag, with that particular foot injury having effectively ended the careers of Yao Ming, Eric Montross, and Bill Walton.
Joel Embiid. In 2014, Embiid was labeled a bust by nearly every major news network as well. In 2018, many memes started to float around of Embiid eating an entire burger only an hour before a game. In 2020, reports came out that he would make rookies buy him 4 whole milkshakes, 4 Chick-fil-A sandwiches, an order of cookies, and 2 to 3 sides of fries, with the total order cost coming out to almost $250, all for one single person. Now, admittedly, these reports are from a couple years after Embiid's injury in 2015, but that doesn't mean these problems weren't already happening. Sportscasting reports these issues go as far back as his college years, where in Kansas, Jayhawks coach Bill Self called Embiid the least mature eater he ever encountered.
Do you have a better idea?
Yes, I do.
In June, this was sort of the start of the playoffs, and not the start of the playoffs, but like towards the finals and everything like that. Sort of wrapping up the season, and I also made a video. Which the thumbnail I really like because I feel like it's a better put together thumbnail and gets the point across. Called The Small Ball Revolution is Real. And again, that just sort of goes back to what I was saying in May where, players are getting shorter and shorter because more people are scoring threes and sort of how that started, how it was before Steph Curry, after Steph Curry, before MJ, after MJ, before Kobe, after Kobe, and so on. And I think it's a really great video, but unfortunately it doesn't have that many views. But I still really like that video. I think it was a pretty good video. Probably the reason it doesn't have that many views is because it's a bit of a longer one. It's about 15 minutes when, again, I like to make my videos about 7 to 8 minutes whenever they're not a podcast episode. But I felt like that video was very informative. And again, I liked the thumbnail for that one. So, but the problem I have with small ball is we keep seeing the height of the league decrease and decrease because the league wants more and more shooters, which we've talked about many times before. And the 3-point is just going up and up. But we're seeing more shot attempts by larger players. We're seeing more shot attempts from larger players like Joel Embiid, Jokic, Giannis getting his jump shot now. And it seems that these taller players are becoming more and more versatile. So the question becomes, does it start to even out anywhere where we have these centers that are able to play like point guards? And there's a graph that I had somewhere that showed the difference in player efficiency based on position. And it was really interesting to see. And the reason I think the graph looked like that, where it sort of looked like, you know, small forwards and shooting guards were starting to see an increase. As you can see here, this is from September of 2021. So this is sort of towards the start of this season. So things have changed a little bit since then, but I think most of the article still holds up. So these are their key findings, which I want to read out. So again, this is by Run Repeat. So it says the average NBA player is 6'6 and has never been shorter over the past 39 seasons. Point guards are the tallest they've ever been in league history. All other positions are the shortest since the 80s. So again, this goes back to what I was saying earlier, which is we can put some of these taller players at a point guard position, even though they might not necessarily be point guards, which is why the point guard is the tallest position and the other ones are getting shorter. 72% of the league is 6'9", or under 6'9", which is the most of the most percentage of a league under 6'9" in the past 40 seasons. And again, this is goes back to what I was saying earlier, this next point here. 40% of the power forwards field goal attempts are three-pointers, first time in NBA history, while centers are getting close to 20%, currently at 19.5%. So again, we're seeing a lot of versatile bigs that are able to get this three-point percentage that we used to not be able to see. You know, we a lot of players used to play like Giannis and just simply go through the paint, and that was their bread and butter. You know, we didn't see people that were 6'10", 7', that were, like, shooting beyond the arc because it was just ridiculous. So around the end of June is when DeJounte Murray got traded, and I said that this trade would actually work out really well for us because we got a lot of picks. We're going to see how those picks turn out at the end of this season, depending on if the Spurs tank or not. And I also said that I wasn't sure how well DeJounte would work for the Hawks because, again, him and Trae Young would have to figure out how to mesh well together. They would have to figure out how to share the ball, and that's exactly what's happening. You know, the Hawks offense has had some issues a couple nights because they have to figure out, you know, who is the first option, who's the second option, and just how they mesh well together and how to share the ball when both of them are essentially point guards, but one of them is going to be put in that shooting guard position if both of them are on the floor. Hey guys, so I'm writing scripts today for other videos, but something literally just happened that I had to make a video about. I don't know if you guys can tell, but I literally just got out of the shower, so this is just blind video, no editing. Like, my phone literally rang about it while I was in the shower, so.
DeJounte Murray has officially been traded to the Atlanta Hawks. It hurts a little bit, but honestly, surprisingly, I'm not that down about it. I know CJ Hoop Talks, you know, CJ Hoop Talks was absolutely, like, depressed about it. I'll leave his video in the description and in the card, but I'm actually not too upset about it because, you know, I'm super high on Primo, and one of the videos I'm literally writing a script about right now is how well we did in this draft, and we didn't really trade for, we didn't get a super high caliber player back. You know, we got Gallinari. Gallinari's still averaging about 11 to 12 points per game, but obviously that's not as much as DeJounte, with DeJounte being an all-star. But that is sort of why we traded him now, is because he's an all-star. This is when his trade stock is at the highest versus if we were to wait a little bit. And the Spurs were sort of on the fence about giving him the max and everything like that. I would have liked for us to give him the max and then get rid of Poeltl instead, and then we would have had, you know, a little bit more money to give him. But at the same time, there's only so much money we can give him because contracts are based off of your previous contract, meaning that even if we had all this money laying around, you know, we can only give him a percent raise of what his previous contract was. So it was pretty clear that he had already sat down with the Spurs and sort of negotiated with them, because he was making all these troll posts about trades and everything. And honestly, in my opinion, I thought he was going to go to the Knicks, because the Knicks draft was really confusing. Nobody really knew what the Knicks were doing. And then DeJounte was doing, I was talking to CJ Hoop Talks about it. DeJounte was doing a lot of lives, Instagram lives in New York, talking about how he loved the city and loved the people. And he was posting him in like the New York Knicks office and everything like that. So I thought he was honestly going to the Knicks rather than the Hawks. But we did still end up getting 3 future picks for him. So I think that's pretty clear what the Spurs are trying to do. You know, we're set on our future. We're rebuilding around a young potential. And I know that's weird to say because DeJounte isn't that old, but I'm really excited for this, honestly.
Well, this team has just won its 5th NBA championship in the last 15 years. Congratulations to Manu Ginobili. Congratulations to the 2014.
Right afterwards in July, was after the draft had happened. This was one of my more controversial videos. It still has a 80% like ratio, but it got a bit more dislikes. And was, did Orlando Magic make the right decision with Paolo Banchero? And it got a bit more views because, again, it was a bit more of a controversial one. But it sort of talked about Paolo's problems playing off ball and that sort of thing. But the thing is that him not playing that well off ball works perfectly, because the Orlando Magic have a lot of off-ball players already, and they needed somebody to facilitate the play a little bit more, play more on-ball, and that is what Paolo excelled at. And now the Magic, as I'm recording this, are on a 9-game winning streak, which obviously has JX Remy very excited. And we talked about that in the most recent podcast episode. So I was really gung-ho for Chet Holmgren. I thought Chet Holmgren was going to do amazing, and unfortunately he got injured. So all of the talk that, you know, I talked the talk, but Chet Holmgren got injured, which I can't control, unfortunately, so it is what it is. I also posted the San Antonio Spurs stole the draft, which, again, was one of my more higher-viewed videos. It got about 1,300 views. If I check real quick, that video got me 30 subscribers, so a lot of people watched it and decided to stay with the channel. About 60 likes. I talked about how Malachi and Sohan are going to fit into the system, and so far that has been correct and accurate. Sohan has been amazing for his defense, which is exactly what I said would happen. Malachi
being really good at mid-range, sort of echoing some takes that Quinn the Spurs fan had previously spoken about. And it did really well, and a lot of people seem to agree with me. And again, we're seeing that later in the season, so that's really good. However, I did talk about how Sohan and Malachi would play off Primo, and unfortunately that is no longer the case. So sort of with that same vein, I posted a video I was really, really proud of because obviously the editing that went into it and everything, and I was really, really proud of this video. It was called The Rebuild, a mini movie, and basically talks about how we are rebuilding and we're going to come back stronger because we had Tony Parker, Ginobili, Tim Duncan, and ever since then everything has been downhill. Got about 2,200 views, 112 likes, a ton of comments positively about the video, and sort of hinting at Victor Wembanyama as well at the end of the video. The only bad part about this is that there was a large focus on Primo in the video with the rebuild, and again, Primo unfortunately is no longer with the Spurs. But I think the point still stands that we are rebuilding, and we will come back stronger. You know, again, we have Sohan, we have Malachi, and we are really putting a great team together. Obviously, we have no way of knowing right now what the pick is, but if the Spurs somehow manage to get Victor Wembanyama, that will be a huge asset that fits perfectly to every piece we now have, and I can't express that enough. Primo would have a big that he can dish out to in the paint if he gets contested on the three, as well as having a mid-range shooter in Malachi should Victor also be tied up. Malachi would then also have another big to perform these pick and roll plays with that we mentioned before. And with Victor averaging about 2 blocks a game, he would be phenomenal alongside Sohan on the defensive end. One thing I haven't even mentioned yet is each of these guys have amazing motors and want to improve, which is excellent for their success in San Antonio. We've seen a few times what happens when people don't want to put in the work, like Luka Sandwich. They are also reportedly already actively experiencing the city of San Antonio and bonding with each other as teammates, which is great to see. Unfortunately, after writing the script for this video, it was reported that Sohan may miss out on the summer league, but I'm still excited for these picks to show what they're capable of, and I do think that this is the start of something great, even if many can't see it yet. With that being said, I'll catch you on the next one.
This team has just won its 5th NBA championship in the last 15 years. Congratulations to Manu Ginobili. Congratulations to the 2014 NBA champion San Antonio Spurs, and to the 2014 NBA Finals Most Valuable Player, Kawhi Leonard.
Players in NBA history, Tim Duncan has announced he is done. He is retiring. Duncan, the first pick that I...
Tough day for Spurs fans, having the second of the big three depart, and who knows what Manu's now going to decide to do.
And he's in pain again in front of the Spurs bench.
The Spurs might get swept. I just want to give him one game out of respect for the great Greg Popovich, but I'm at a struggle. I'm at a loss to find out how they're going to win a game.
Yeah, DeMar DeRozan in Chicago. So the sign and trade route.
We'll be returning to the Nets on a 2-year, $14.5 million deal.
Tonight, DeJounte Murray traded away to Atlanta, and just over an hour ago, Murray sent out a message to San Antonio. Let's bring in sports anchor Nate Ryan. Nate, the Spurs' best player, now headed out of town.
Yeah, he's rumors of a potential Murray trade all week. We didn't think the Spurs would actually do it, but alas, the 25-year-old All-Star off to Atlanta for 3 future first-round picks. Now, the Spurs haven't officially announced the deal, but Murray himself acknowledging it with a post on social media. Murray saying, quote, "San Antonio, I love you forever. Thank you, Spurs, and the whole city for believing in me and embracing me from day one. I want to write a whole book about it, but it's not easy. We are family, and it's always going to be bigger than basketball clothes."
Spurs traded guard DeJounte Murray to Atlanta last night for 3 first-round picks and Danilo Gallinari. It's a nice backcourt pairing for the Hawks now with Murray and Trae Young. Nick, what'd you make of this trade?
I like it for both teams. I think this is a difference maker. I think this is a difference maker, Rick, for the Hawks. I like DeJounte Murray a lot, and I know what you're going to say.
Picking up this ex-Spurs player's bobblehead.
DeJounte Murray.
Yeah, DeJounte. He was our favorite player.
It's devastating, devastating. I love DeJounte.
I don't know. Officially rebuild. Big Three's gone. Kawhi's gone. DeJounte's gone.
We were already in a rebuild, and now we're rebuilding again. So, I mean, what's that about?
I'm a little upset. I wish we would keep him. Just, we want another title eventually.
I don't know about that unless we get somebody big, but we haven't got anybody big since.
Yo, no cap, bro. The Spurs have been boring for so long. I don't think they'll ever, like, remove that. They could have been flashy this year for all we know, but because we just think, like, San Antonio would have been boring basketball.
12th? Yeah. With all the people on the roster, what is happening here?
The Spurs have fallen from grace.
The San Antonio Spurs was named as the least watchable team in NBA by USA Today.
With the 12th pick in the 2021 NBA Draft, the San Antonio Spurs select Joshua Primo from Toronto.
In the beginning, you know, people were talking about, why is he on the team? You should have taken him. What happened to him? Why is he there? All the pundits, all these people who think they know something. And then, just like to say to all those people out there, how the f*** you like us now?
The San Antonio Spurs select Jeremy Sochan from Milton Keynes, England, and Baylor University. Select Malachi Branham from The Ohio State University. Select Blake Wesley from
With Chet Holmgren, I posted a video on July 15th called "Chet Holmgren is Perfect for OKC." Once again, I stand behind what I said in this video. Chet Holmgren fits with OKC perfectly. You know, I feel like he will play amazingly. Unfortunately, he is a bit skinny, which is the criticism a lot of people had before. So he did get injured, which I said he is skinny, but he won't get injured. And unfortunately, he did, so I got proven wrong with that. But I do think he still will be amazing. And we'll just have to wait and see whenever he comes back from injury. And then right after that, I actually went out of town in Houston for a convention with some of my friends, which I really enjoyed. And then we move on to August. Go shawty, it's your birthday. We gon' party like it's your birthday. We gon' sip Bacardi like. So in August, I posted one of my more popular videos. It had got about 3,500 views. It's called Victor Wembanyama is perfect for the Spurs. And, I mean, what else is there more to say? He is perfect for the Spurs. Once again, the Spurs should be tanking for him, in my opinion. A lot of people still debating on that. You know, people like the Spurs winning. Obviously, people like when their team wins. But it's sort of a think about the future type thing. And we need to get Victor Wembanyama at all cost, because he will be amazing, especially under Pop's leadership. Again, this got about 3,500 views. I gained 20 subscribers from this video, and about 20 comments, and it just talked about how Victor can play off of Malachi, off of Sohan, off of Primo, off of really anybody, and how amazing that Victor will be, especially in Pop's system. So again, if you haven't seen it, go check that one out, because that was a huge video on the channel and did really well. After this, I sort of switched up my thumbnails a bit for the podcast episodes and sort of experimenting how well they did. And I also got Clan the Spurs fans merch, so y'all go check that out. I really enjoy it. I'm hoping to order some more. I just haven't already because of, you know, rent and other things. Because this is also whenever I moved into my new apartment, which is really cool. And what y'all are seeing now, which gives me a lot more independence whenever I'm recording videos. Because, you know, I don't have to worry about relatives or family members, you know, making a bunch of noise. You know, I still have roommates, but usually they're pretty chill whenever I record. And I can kind of do whatever I want. You know, I have a lot of, you know, my own room at my disposal. The apartment has opened a lot of doors for me. And I'm hoping that I can get another apartment whenever I have more money. Because obviously, again, I have roommates now, and it is sort of a smaller space. So I'm hoping maybe, like, getting a bigger space so I can have, like, a whole wall behind me that is Nathan Butnett, and so y'all don't have my bed in the frame whenever I record the podcast. But, obviously moving into the apartment was a huge thing in my, like, IRL life that reflected on to the podcast. So, guys, so I just wanted to do a real quick video because something came in the mail today. The From label says Clan the Merch Fan, so I think you know what's in store. So let's go ahead and open this. I know what I ordered, but I'm excited to finally see it. So let's. Look at that. Get the card and everything. And thank you for your support. Obviously, we're always going to help the man Clan out, you know, he's friend of the channel. So, now, for the reveal. Look at that. It looks sick. Let me go ahead and put this on real quick. Alrighty, there we go, guys. For all my Spurs fans out there, I'll leave the link to it in Clan's stuff in the description, but this is fucking dope. Hell yeah, bro. Alright, I just wanted to kind of show it off. I'm hyped that my shirt finally got here. But anyway, that's all I got for this one, guys. Hey, peace out. Alrighty, we should be live. Nathan Bennett, episode 32. It's more of a chill episode. We're not actually going to talk that much basketball, just some announcement type stuff. So, as you can see, I'm in a different place. Finally moved into the new apartment that I've been talking about. The layout is pretty much the same, though. As you can see, we got the shelf behind me, as usual. It's a bit of a little bit closer to the camera now, though, so y'all can actually see it. And then, of course, we got all the pennants and the newspaper and all that, and then the bed behind me. So that's why I'm sort of sitting at a diagonal angle, because I want y'all to see the shelf and then also sort of cover up my bed a little bit.
Let's use the secret entrance.
With in September, this is whenever it got a bit hard for me to upload every day. I took a little bit of a break, and I posted why I was going to take a break. But I have now privated that video because it was a lot of talk about like mental health, that sort of thing, and just being hard to upload every now and then. And in September, though, I also again experimented a little bit with different thumbnails, that sort of thing. And that just moves us into October, where in October I sort of tried to be more consistent coming back from the break, and also took more initiative with what I was going to upload. You know, kept up with basketball a lot more. So I could post things like videos about the Kings, videos about Primo, videos about what Adam Silver is talking about, you know, Adam Silver talking about tanking. You know, the Draymond Green fight was a huge thing for a while. And then obviously talking about things that are going on that maybe people aren't talking about, to sort of, you know, dig into sort of a hole in the market type thing, rather than talking about oversaturated videos, which are really hot right now, even though I did talk about, you know, the Draymond Green fight, because that was what was going on at the time. You know, a lot of people were posting about the Draymond Green fight, so I wanted to choose something else that nobody's talking about. So that's when I started getting the actual San Antonio newspaper and the San Antonio articles about the Spurs that, you know, people that outside of San Antonio, even if they may be Spurs fans and talk about, they don't have access to, like the way I have access to. You know, take those advantages where I have them, and, you know, utilize what is at my disposal. So that's when I posted the legal action to keep Spurs in San Antonio video, which was something that was posted in the San Antonio newspaper, about how there are sports laws that are going to Congress that have to do with the Spurs and other teams and the world of sports. But again, people aren't going to know about it if I don't make a video on it, or other people that live in San Antonio don't make a video on it, or if they don't read the newspaper. So,
after all the reassurance that the Spurs will stay in San Antonio, there's still plenty of people speculating. With the Spurs playing more games in Austin and them continuously losing money while losing games, many are still on edge. However, with me myself living in San Antonio, I have more connections and more of an attachment to this issue than some other basketball or even out-of-state Spurs fans might have. This includes none other than the San Antonio newspaper. In this publication of the paper, there's an article titled "Bill Puts Pressure on Spurs to Stay in SA." To summarize, the article goes on to explain a new bill that has gone all the way to Congress, the Strengthening Public Undertaking for Retaining Sports Act, or cleverly named the Spurs Act. Now, the purpose of this bill does not make it impossible for teams to relocate, because this would cause a lot of further issues in setting precedents. Without getting too much into the politics, if relocating a team was outright prohibited, this would be seen as influencing the free market too much, because each team is a business. So rather than not allowing the relocation of teams at all, the bill instead makes it far more difficult and essentially creates a checklist before a team can be relocated.
Getting into November, I didn't post, like, at all in November. I posted two videos in November, and they were at the very end of November, and one of them was a YouTube short. So technically, I only posted one video, but that was about the Sacramento Kings. Did pretty well, got about 200 views. I think this is a really well-researched video. Didn't have any comments, didn't have any likes, despite having a lot of views. But I liked the research that I did for that video. I backed up everything pretty well. And sort of shows how my videos have evolved. It's about 10 minutes long, so I was able to pick apart more from the information that I was gathering and sort of break everything down a little bit more. You know, if I go from only being able to talk 3 minutes about something to talking about 10 minutes about something, then I'm able to extrapolate more data from what I'm looking at and make a more cohesive video that really dives deeper, which I think is really important and shows how far like I've evolved and hopefully will continue to evolve in that sort of way. And then coming into December, you know, this last month, I think is really, really where I decided to hunker down, especially finishing the semester. And I decided, even if these videos don't get that many views, I want to put out like really cool content that I'm proud of and that I know takes a lot of research and time. And so the proving which NBA season is the most competitive, it may have gotten less than 100 views, but it got 12 likes, 6 comments. People loved it that watched it. And that is because, again, like that video took me months to make, and it's one of the videos I am the most proud of because of the amount of effort and everything that went into it. And all of the different data and information and everything that I collected and organized together in order to make that video. It was a huge project, a huge undertaking that I decided to do for that video. And again, I'm really proud of it, even if the views don't show it. It's one of my favorite videos because, again, I had been working on it for months. I had been holding and sitting on that video for months. And just so much that had went into making it. After that, I posted, again, Are Scoring Records Meaningless? Sort of a flashback to the very beginning of the year with the Are Triple Doubles Overrated? Just sort of going over the same thing, talking about and then comparing it to LeBron and Kareem and some other things and how much these records truly mean now. And it was just sort of cool that it wasn't even intentional, but just the way that one of my last videos of the year sort of echoes one of my first videos from the year. And so because of that, there is sort of a cool comparison that you can make, like almost the same video twice, where you can compare, like, this is where I was at the beginning of the year and at the end of the year about the same sort of topic, which I think is really cool. With that being said, I wanted to save sort of the speech type stuff to the end of the video rather than putting it at the end of the video. But y'all have been crazy supportive this year, and I really appreciate it. Because I did post the podcast on Spotify, there was Spotify did like a recap type thing, and it showed like the support that y'all have shown. You know, my podcast is being listened to in different countries, which is really cool. So like, shout out to Portugal, shout out to Germany, shout out to any country outside the US that watches me. That's really cool. Even though we still don't get that many listens on Spotify, like the rate at which the listeners have increased is really cool. Like we barely got any listeners like last year whenever I started posting on Spotify. And now we're obviously like we're not like in the hundreds or thousands or millions or anything on the listens, like, per episode. But the total listens throughout the year is, like, in the thousands, I'm pretty sure. And the rate, like, the amount of listeners compared to last year is, like, something like a 60% increase, which is really cool. And then, obviously, with YouTube, I didn't hit 500 subscribers at the end of the year, which I really wanted to, but I'm still not too discouraged by that because I'm still on 485. Whenever I started the year, I was, like, barely on 100, and I had to, like, beg people last year to get me to 100 because I was on, like, in the 90s, and I wanted to hit 100 really bad. And then once I hit 100, again, I posted that Victor Wembanyama video, I posted that Doc Rivers video, I posted that Cade Cunningham video, and those three really exploded this year, where, like, last year I had the Primo video, and the Primo video was sort of the only video that broke, like, 1,000, and it was, like, my huge video. And this year I had three videos like that that really exploded, and I went from, like, 100 subscribers to, even though I didn't hit 500, almost 500, and almost multiplied my subscribers this year by 5. So thank you guys so much for that. Like, that's really cool, like, the rate at which this channel is growing. And I think that's partly because y'all are supporting me so much. Like, I ask y'all in every video to, like, share the video around and, like, subscribe and all that. And again, like, those videos that really popped off, like, I was getting, like, 30 new subscribers on, like, the Victor video, like, 15 new subscribers on the Doc Rivers video, like, 100 new subscribers on the Cade Cunningham video, because y'all are sharing it around, and the people that enjoy it are subscribing, which is really cool. So again, like, the support this year has been really cool. And I'll put in, like, the whole Spotify recap and sort of do a commentary over it and, like, my thoughts on it. But I don't know. I don't know what else to say other than that, like, other than repeating myself. Like, this year, y'all have just really supported me. And it's been really cool because this is something I want to continue. I've talked about many times, like, one of my goals is to sort of, like, take this podcast on the road one day and, like sort of do, like, a podcast episode in each city, like, do a Cleveland Cavaliers episode, like, a Minnesota episode, a New York episode, like, that type of thing, which I think would be really cool. But the only way I can do that is if there's enough people that support it, which, y'all are really, doing and really helping me to get there, which is really cool. So of course, like, shout out to all the amazing guests that have, like, been shout out to all the guests that have been on this podcast, because they obviously have helped me out a lot, especially Quinn the Spurs fan, because, you know, he's got, like, 7,000 subscribers now, and he still looks out for some channels that are under him and humble enough to appreciate good takes and talk to people like me that aren't even at that 1,000 sub goal yet, as long as our takes are good. And then Swish Eel as well, you know, Swish Eel's a fan of Clan, so me Clan and Swish Eel, you know, sort of have this trifecta going on. And then you know, there's JX Remy, who was on the latest episode. He's amazing. CJ Hoop Talks, of course, he posts more on Instagram than YouTube now, but he still shouts me out every now and then. Me and him support each other, you know, he's an amazing guy. I hope I'm not forgetting anybody. You know, JX Remy, CJ Hoop Talks, Swish Eel, Clan the Spurs fan, just all the guests that have been on this year have been amazing, and really helped boost the channel. So I don't know what else to say, guys. Again, whenever I talk about, like, the Spurs or the Spotify recap and, like, the YouTube recap, I'll go more into it. But y'all have really supported this year, so I really appreciate it. And I hope you enjoyed this best of, and looking at how the channel has really evolved, and that is partly due to you guys, because again, like, I really appreciate that y'all don't hold back. If a video isn't good, if a take isn't good, y'all let me know. If a video is good, y'all also let me know, and that tells me how I should, like, edit videos, how I should research videos, what takes are good, what takes are bad, what takes maybe you agree on, what takes you think are hot takes, and that that allows me to get better knowledge in this sphere and helps me grow sort of my authority and profile in the basketball space, and helps me to keep continuously get better and know what y'all appreciate and what y'all don't appreciate. So it's greatly appreciated. But anyway, I know y'all are sick of like all the ranting and all that stuff. So hopefully we can keep evolving the channel like we have evolved over this last year. And I will see y'all in the next one. So peace out, guys.